Inner Traditions Audio presents The Gospel of Thomas, The Gnostic Wisdom of Jesus by Jean-Yves Leloup, read by Andy Rick. Foreword. Among all the astonishing documents accidentally or fatefully unearthed in 1945 near the desert village of Nag Hammadi in Upper Egypt, the Gospel of Thomas has made the greatest impact on our understanding of Christianity. The first English rendering of this text was published in 1959 and was greeted with intense interest by scholars and theologians alike. But the impact of this document was soon felt far beyond the circles of specialists, almost as though an audible recording of the voice of Jesus had been discovered. That is to say, that even across the reaches of millennial time and even through the curtain of translation from languages known to but a few, for many of us, the words in this text have the power to touch an unknown part of ourselves that brings with it an undeniable recognition of truth and hope. When it was said of Jesus, by those who were at first bewildered by him, that he spoke as one having authority, what is surely meant is that he and his teaching authenticated itself by their power to awaken that same hidden, self-authenticating part of the human heart and mind. Here we have the key to approaching the fundamental category that scholars and theologians have applied to this document and those like it, the technical term Gnosticism. It is a word that in fact points to something of great importance to our understanding of all the spiritual traditions of the world and, as such, of great importance to our understanding of human life itself. When scholars apply the label Gnostic to the documents found at Nag Hammadi, they are generally assigning them to the current of religious doctrines and practices that flourished in the early centuries of the Christian era and were condemned as heresy in a movement spearheaded in the second century by the redoubtable Bishop of Lyons, Irenaeus. The eventual result of this condemnation was the widespread suppression of these heresies and the relentless destruction of their constitutive texts. Until now, most of what was known of these teachings was based on the adversarial accounts of them provided in Irenaeus's vastly influential work, Against the Heresies. The immense historical significance of the Nag Hammadi documents consists in the likelihood that they were buried by members of some of these communities in order to preserve them from the storm of the ecclesiastical book burning of the time. Thus, nearly 2,000 years after the suppression of these so-called heresies, we now suddenly have the opportunity to look directly at aspects of their teachings instead of seeing them largely through the eyes of their enemies. But although the texts themselves can now be directly seen for the first time in nearly 2,000 years, really to see them is a task that invites us to something much more demanding and joyous than simply reading them off the pages of ancient scrolls or modern translations, and interpreting them according to familiar habits of intellectual analysis. It is not for nothing that in this document, the very first words of Jesus, here called by the Aramaic name Yeshua, are these: "Whoever lives the interpretation of these words will no longer taste death." Is this merely a figure of speech, or do these words speak to some kind of knowledge and knowing that have an action upon the very flesh and blood of a human being, an action that is incomparably more penetrating than anything we call knowledge or knowing, including even our inspired moments of intellectual insight or passionate realization? Is there some kind of knowing that can transform our being to the point, dare we imagine, of bringing forth a life that does not die when the body dies? Such knowing as this is inseparable from the action of faith, considered not simply as a set of emotionally charged beliefs, but as a movement within the human psyche that generates a magnetic current flowing between our individual human life and the source of human life itself. and that deposits into our human life the spiritualized matter of what is called the new Adam. And that enables a man or woman actually to answer in an entirely new way the great cry of St. Paul, "For the good that I would, that I do not, and that which I hate, that do I." Or, in other words, to answer with the actions of love rather than with brittle promises of future virtue. Such transformational knowing actually has little or nothing to do with what we ordinarily call thought. It has to do with energy, the energy of consciousness. This energy is at the heart of what is signified by the ancient word gnosis, from which Gnosticism is derived. In applying the term Gnosticism to these teachings, scholars and theologians understandably call our attention to the emphasis that most of the Nag Hammadi documents place on the role of knowledge in the religious life, in apparent contrast to the demand for faith that became the central tenet of the Church over the centuries, especially in the West. There are numerous other doctrines that are sometimes identified with Gnosticism, such as its apparent metaphysical dualism and condemnation of the world. But it is the notion of gnosis as transformational knowing that is of utmost importance and that cries out for deeper inquiry in the world we now live in, a world, a civilization, which is deeply, perhaps fatally, afflicted with an ever-widening disconnect between what we know with the mind and what we know in our heart and in our instincts. Both in our civilization and in our personal lives, the growth of knowledge far outstrips the growth of being, endlessly complicating our existence and taking away from us far more than it gives us. In relation to the advances and applications of scientific knowledge, we are like children restlessly sitting at the controls of a locomotive. Without a corresponding growth of inner, moral power, our intellectual power seems now to be carrying us toward disaster, in the form of the catastrophic destruction of the natural world, in the decay of ethical values, in the secrets of biological life falling under the sway of blind commerce or blind superstition, and above all, in the impending worldwide nuclear terror. May we not therefore say, as Plato said 2,500 years ago, that such knowledge as we have does not really deserve the label knowledge? Can we listen to him as he tells us that knowledge without virtue can neither bring us good nor show us truth? This is to say that such knowing as we have is not transformational. It does not elevate our level of being, and it does not nourish the development of moral power. It is only the fully developed human being, which means only the fully developed human mind in which the intuition of objective value is an essential component, that can see the world as it really is, and that, through its action upon our instincts and impulses, can lead us toward the capability to act in the service of the good. The present text is offered to us by Jean-Yves Leloup, not so much as a commentary on these words of Jesus, but as a meditation that arises from the tilled earth of our silence. I take this to mean that it is through the author's own inner opening toward the self that his scholarly and theological skills take their ultimate direction in translating and interpreting what he rightly calls this sublime jewel of a gospel. In other words, there may be, and I believe there are, two kinds or levels of knowing operating in this book. On one level, the visible level of words and concepts, there are the insights and explanations that will help every serious reader think in a new way about the meaning of the teaching of Jesus, a way that does not in any way deny the greatness of Christian doctrine that has brought comfort to countless millions of men and women throughout the ages. But for Leloup, this kind of knowing about the Christian religion, precious as it is secondary to a deeper kind given through the grace that is the fruit of the inner work of meditation. And what words can characterize passage to this deeper level of knowing? Leloup puts it this way: there exists a relative consciousness formed and acquired through readings, encounters, and the thoughts of others. And he goes on to say, but there is also a consciousness that arises directly from knowledge of ourselves, of the living one within us. It is toward this consciousness, this gnosis, that Yeshua invites us in the Gospel of Thomas, not in order to become good Christians, but to become Christs, in other words, Gnostics, or awakened human beings. This deeper knowing may properly be called pure consciousness, or perhaps more precisely, the pure energy of consciousness. It is an energy, no doubt itself existing at many levels, that can be allowed to descend into the body, heart, and mind, and, through its own active force, make of us the being called Anthropos, the awakened, fully human being. This energy is not what we ordinarily call thought, but it is this energy that has the power to do what we have wrongly imagined our ordinary thought can do. It can direct all our functions, including our mental thought. This book, therefore, as is true of Jean-Yves Leloup's presentations of the Gospel of Mary and the Gospel of Philip, which are also Gnostic texts, is in itself a step toward the work of the mind that desperately needs to be rediscovered in our era. The proper work of the mind is to function at two levels, the level of silence and the level of expression. And it is expression that is secondary. That is, truth in the form of words and formulations can come only out of silence, the state of the pure energy of consciousness anterior to its assumption of forms, words, ideas, associations, the organization of impressions, images, programs. The mind alone, the mind that is not nourished by the silence of the fertile void of pure being, as such is incapable of guiding human life. The ordinary, isolated intellect, no matter how brilliant or inspired, has not the energy to command our thoughts, words, impulses, memories, and experiences in a way that conforms to truth and the good. This, in sum, is the tragedy of our era, of our knowledge in the modern world.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.